I've got a hobby of collecting images of architects from different ages. So this one's a carving from the cathedral at Fulham, and it shows the client on the left and the right with the new church that they've paid for, and then in the middle with the architect holding the whole thing up. I love the contrast between the clients that appear to be holding with them with their fingertips, and their eyes are cast upward, and they're obviously having a great time, and there's the architect in the middle. To some extent, that interest in collecting images of architects relates to a more underlying interest, which is about the figure of the architect and what the status of the architect is in contemporary society. And not a broad social interest, it's more a kind of a wish to find what part of the world you can get purchase in as a practicing architect and under what terms you can get purchase. And it does appear to me that at the moment the figure of the architect is changing quite considerably. There are lots of reasons for that. There are a couple of issues that come up as a consequence of that in the work. One of them is the relationship between the sort of the strong desire that architects have to construct their practice, perhaps as being making buildings for the people who are nearby and the materials that are nearby using the labour that's nearby. That sense that Ruskin or Pugin would have understood as an authentic architectural practice, which goes back to an idea from the Middle Ages, the hands of the maker and so on. Which is possible in a certain kind of project. But then the other one is a sort of abstract, project-managed, large-scale, urban, international way in which architecture moves around, and particularly it's communicated through a culture of images. Many of the buildings I know about them from Design or something like that. And so what I'm doing is I'm consuming buildings as images, and to some extent, unconsciously, I'm probably trying to produce buildings which will be images which will pass muster and get into Design. So you get a production of images within architectural culture, which is very different to the sort of grounded idea of communities making pieces of the world for themselves. And it's that relationship between groundedness as an idea and the reality of international abstract production that seems to me to create certain crises within architecture. And the final one is to do with the issue of meaning itself, because in the past, communities would have gone to buildings and understood the meaning of the building not simply as a description of itself, but a description of the society that made it. So last week I was in Auckland in New Zealand looking at Maori huts, and it's perfectly clear that all of the carvings and all of the representations in the huts embodied an idea about ancestry and belonging, which any Maori looking at would have understood implicitly. And what modern building that we think about that communicates meaning in that way? And certain art theorists have made a claim that I think I agree with, which is that when ideas of God and the stability of government became disputed and no longer the site for permanent or agreed meaning, what tended to happen in most art practice is that the communication of meaning fell back on the object itself, whether it's a sculpture, an abstract painting, a piece of music, or a building. And so you get formulations like truth to materials, truth to structure, form follows function. These are all communicating meanings about the building which I would say are intrinsic. In other words, they're falling back on the building itself. They're not telling parables about society. And the extent to which architects hope that those meanings will be communicable to other people is something that bears inspection. Is it really true that people will look at a building which possesses all of those merits and feel it's a better building than one which communicates parables about the society that they belong to? But the difficulty with those parables is there's no longer a agreed or constituted repertoire of images that we can use to bedeck or adorn our buildings with. And so there's a kind of a blankness that comes from that. One of my favourite architectural writers, Karl Pottinger, in 1845, described the conditions of production at the beginning of the Industrial Age, and he said, "What I see in front of me is a great blankness." And I think we live in that time of blankness and time of meaning. But things are, in a sense, unable to describe much more than their own properties, and I think that gives us a crisis for architecture. So coming out of that, I'm going to show you a number of projects, I think six projects this afternoon. The first two are made in conditions which you would have thought were ideal for an architect, relatively wealthy clients. One designing a house in a rural little, and the second one designing a small piece of city in a traditional European city. The middle two are attempts that I've made to try and think about how architecture can communicate meaning outside itself using issues of technology, history, and so on. And the final two are a pair of projects which are recently completed. One for housing for the Olympics and the other a private chapel, which offer, I think, a contrast in terms of the means of production or the conditions of production under which the architect worked. So without further ado, let's begin on the project. I'm going to show these rather dumb maps from Google Earth, just because as I was leaving the office, I thought, gosh, well, people in Australia know where Cork and Bristol are. So maybe you do, but if you don't, here's a little front. So West Cork is, the point here is almost the most westerly point of Europe. It's an extremely rainy environment. They say there that it's not raining, it's about to rain. Mizzen Head is this wonderful whale watching site. It's also close to the Fastnet Rock, which is the most westerly point in Europe. And you're getting the Gulf Stream, getting warm and moist air coming in. The client's house is on a site which faces this wonderful archipelago, which you can see on the right-hand side of the image, but it faces more or less east, while the weather, the sun, the wind, and the rain are all coming from the southwest. The client is an interesting man. He's probably one of the most influential people in Irish society. He was the person who landed the Uruguay round of the GATT World Trade Talks, which is one of the great sort of achievements of world trade. He was at different times head of British Petroleum, Goldman Sachs, London School of Economics. So he's a big beast, and he wants to build him which would sort of represent himself. He said, I could spend money on it, but it shouldn't be obvious that a lot of money had been spent. The building should be quiet in terms of the way it presents itself to the community. And secondly, that it should be sober, and that he saw as being as defined in virtue. So I thought, I'll do a really sober building. The site here, beautiful site looking east, you can see the road. I haven't got a pointer on this one, but this road here goes out to Mizzen Head, and it's about a story and a half above the level of the land. There's a wonderful sliding slope of rock here, the microchips, another one here. And you get this broad, simple valley, which is about twice the width of this room, running from the road down to the sea. And through that valley, a little river which comes down from the farmland and just empties out over the rocks into the water. It was an existing, white-rendered, Irish 1970s house that she asked us to keep, and everything else we were given to do. So we thought we'd make a kind of a dam across the valley and try and capture space between these two rather beautiful rock faces. The plant on these rocks is called gorse. I don't know if it's common here in Australia, but it's a plant that flares up into a bright yellow colour at certain seasons of the year. And so we have these dark black rocks and this bright yellow gorse on the sides of them, framing this kind of broad swathe of meadow going down towards the sea. And the simple plan of the building, you can see on the left-hand side, the cottage which was existing, and then stepping down a series of very simple, we call them ingot-like forms. They're sort of like a megaron or something. And you can see here the stream which flows down into the sea, and the stream at one point goes through the building, and we make courtyards on each side framing the building between the rock faces. We had the opportunity here to make a building which was sober and made from a material that most people can't afford to build, and it was our way of doing something that wasn't ostentatious, but we could use the money available to make something substantial. And this is a church by Pugin in Cork, and what I loved about it is in this photograph it's a kind of a dull grey. But most of the time, when it's raining in Cork, the building goes this extraordinarily glossy black. And sometimes the church looks like a stealth bomber or something. It's wonderful how it looks better in the wet. And I thought, wouldn't it be good to do a building that always looks at its best when it's pouring rain? The old building, which dates from the 6th century, is a monastic chapel on an island off the coast. And to me, this is one of the most beautiful pieces of architecture I've ever seen. The sense of stone being explored to its absolute limit to make something. I use the word ingot, I'm sure you can understand what I mean. And I thought it had an almost Inca-like quality, the sort of thing you might find in Machu Picchu. And we wanted to use stone to make something which had some of that kind of closed in on itself, an object-like quality. And that led us to these paintings by Joseph Albers, the artist who was interested in Mesoamerica, and the way that the unfolding of these forms, we imagined that these might be gables or something like that. And so the construction of this building is related to making something as massive as we can possibly make it. And where you get a lot of the architecture I've seen here in all its virtues is dependent on very thin walls and a sense of lightness that comes from thin walls. But in the west of Ireland and with current building regulations, you're looking at huge amounts of insulation. So what we've got here is a 300mm thick reinforced concrete core form, which is giving you the structure and it's also giving you the thermal mass, which is guaranteeing the temperature stability of the building. It's heavily insulated under the floor slab, and there's a 350mm, 400mm blanket of insulation around the outside. That combined with a ground source heat pump means that you can keep the temperature of the building more or less stable all the way through the year without having to put any extra energy into it. So you're just running the motor of the heat pump all the time, and the building is super insulated, and so the only issue you've got is to try and vent off the heat when you get the occasional warm day in summer. On top of that, we've got a load-bearing ashlar wall, which is, in a sense, traditional cavity construction, except with a much larger cavity. and then it flips when we get to the roof. I haven't got a pointer, but you can see the black dotted line, which is an EPDM membrane, which runs over the insulation. So the roof itself becomes a rain screen. We can use six stone slabs on that roof to create a sense that the walls and the roof of the building are all made from the same material, which gives you that solidity. Thank you very much. So you can see the EPDM membrane starting here, running down and filling a secret gutter, and then you just get a tiny slot here where the water, which is gushing off the roof, will run down into that, but most of it makes its way down into that layer and into the concealed gutter underway. And so everything in the building is made from either polished, flamed, or honed stone, which is the local stone. And that gives us the opportunity to create these very simple forms. So starting at the top of the site, the stream that runs through, and the driveway that comes a whole story height down, the existing cottage, which is just tidied up and made to look decent, the two rock faces on either side, and then this flipping back and forth, courtyard, building, courtyard, courtyard, building, courtyard, building, courtyard, building. And so as you move down through the building, you're looking left and right, opening into different courtyards all the time. And the stream fills a pool here, which passes through the building and out into the sea. And this drawing here, we really try to get that shard or finger-like quality that the metamorphic rocks have in this part of the coast. And so this is a working model of the project. The courtyards here and here and here and here and here, and the ingot-like forms of the buildings. And by taking this very simple mono-pitch form, when you needed to, the slope of the coast or the run of the stream, you could cut it open in different ways and then allow the geometry of the building to be released out of the different angles at which you cut the thing open. And this gives us a sense of the plan, which is relatively straightforward. The old cottage has got the storehouse for canoes and boats, the guest room. The important thing is that when he comes from Cork Airport, the housekeeper has lit the fire. When he comes down the drive, the fire, you have a blank white wall, the fire lit in the chimney, and you can see the fire burning from the road. So you see a white wall with the fire burning and a chimney beneath it. When you come in the front door, which is just beside that, there's a long axis which takes you right down through all the volumes. At the end of that axis is a window. Because the ground drops, the view out that window is actually only over the surface of the sea. It's the only thing that you see. So you get this framing of the house between a kind of a manifestation of fire and water at two ends of this axis. As you drift down, the courtyards open up. Courtyard, master bedroom, dining table, courtyard, kitchen, pond, courtyard from the kitchen here, which is pure south facing. And then you come down with this great view of the fastened wall to the east. And at the end of that, you can step through the sitting room. When he wants to go to work, he goes to his study. And I like the idea that you should put your hat on to go to work. So you open a stone door on the stone wall, step on one stone, step in stone, open another stone door, and go into here. And then the view there is to a Norman castle on an island about 2 miles away. So that tilt gives you the Norman castle. And then the pond comes through the building at that. Well, that's not indoors, it comes through and goes out and fills the roof down to the sea. And you can see the sort of nature of these forms. This is the trough which fills the stream here. So it's a black stone trough which comes through. We planted three trees in the three courtyards. We made a bet with the client's wife. She said they would all die because of the salt. But we nearly won, but that one died, and these two so far have survived. It's a very rugged and brutal climate. And so this is the view coming down the driveway and seeing the blank white wall of the existing house with the new chimney which we have built and the space for the fire on the chimney. When you come in the door, you get this axis down and you have the surface of the sea. And then this gives you the sense of the kind of ingot-like forms. One thing that really thick wall construction gives you is the opportunity to think about where you place the window. And I've always felt that some of the thinness of modern architecture relates to the lack of opportunity you have to explore the depth of the wall. So here what we've done is to make a very simple rule. We invented a timber frame silicon glazed structural glass window here, which is pushed right out onto the surface of the building. So the walls of the building are sheer and flush. But where you put the gables open up, we've pushed it right back 750mm into the depth of the building. So you get the chance to explore the three-dimensional property of the reveal at the ends of the gables, and at the same time to keep kind of ingot-like quality of the front flush. And then that keeps everything inside is as simple as it can be, using the stone again and again and again. The only other thing we use is a roco, so the stone is a flooring material, joinery material, and so we just use the timber for joinery, that's what I mean. And then you're seeing here the expression between the depth of the reveal being explored as something which you perceive on the inside looking at it and then on the outside looking back in. And we can see here the point where the kitchen courtyard opens up and fills that pool. This is a view of the house itself, and there's that view from the gables to those rock faces at the end, which close your view all the time. but you have the opportunity to align the inside of the reveal with timber so that the light coming up from the water plays not just inside the reveal, but sometimes it radiates the whole roof. This was done before there was any landscaping put in, I'm afraid, but I think this was the biggest sheet of glass in Ireland, 7 metres by 3 metres, and it is opening out towards the fastened rock in the distance. And then this is the little door between the two rooms, the kind of Inca-like quality of these two objects sort of nearly connecting and having these kind of mute and heavy doors that open up. And sometimes looking between the buildings you get that sense of the reflectiveness of the stone. But these are the open gables looking back towards the rock face and the cliff. So that's taken with my back to one of the cliffs, looking towards the other one. And these are the kind of characteristics that we were looking for, this kind of mute quality. You can see here the tiny gutter detail, which is where the stone comes down and fills that gutter there. This is the water trough there in the pool, and this is one of the strawberry trees that survived. And we were able to move from this sort of very solid quality to absolutely pencil-thin stone at the edges. And the Estonian masons who made it really reveled in the opportunity to make these three-dimensional forms, because they're complete solid stones, but we don't miter them to the junction, but we actually make them out of solid bits of rock. So you get that sense of the real sort of plastic or sculptural property that's available to the stonework. And then that almost monastic, well, this is this study at the end, that almost monastic quality which we want to build into health. The beauty of it is that in Ireland, the nicest moment is when it's been raining, and then the wind and the sun blow the clouds away, and you get that bright light that you get just air cream, rain washed, bright sunlight. And at that point, the whole building becomes highly reflective because of the wetness of the stone. In the sense that was a characteristic which we were looking for. This gives you the maybe referring back to Joseph Albers' image, the kind of people like quality that we want to have. These closed, sober, almost monumental forms. It's relatively rare. This house was about £6,000 or £7,000 a square metre, which is at the high end you could build a residential for. And all of the money was spent on the stonework. It's not elaborately kept out on the inside. And so you realise that that highly crafted possibility comes from having budgets that allow you to do it, to work in stone in that way. The next project, which is an intervention into a typical European historic city, is Oxford. And there's an extraordinary site that's opened up where the old Central Hospital in Oxford was vacated by the NHS, leaving this huge industrial health complex behind. The university bought it and knocked every non-listed building down. There are amazing listed buildings on the site. This is the Radcliffe Observatory, which was built to observe the transit of Venus. The other thing that observed that was Captain Cook's first voyage. So it's an amazing piece of history, the construction of this building. The infirmary itself, the Palladian building. And then the Oxford University Press, which made Bibles and dictionaries for the colonies. It was a very, very devout institution, and they built their own church to serve the workers. But now we're left with this completely empty site, which has just got the vaguest trace of some Iron Age barrels on the ground, but nothing else. And the job that we had, which was a competition which we won, was to design a building that runs from here to here, which is just under half a mile, and the building could only be 6 metres deep. The reason for this was that the university ceded 6 metres of land to Somerville College, which is Britain's first women's college, in order to make the newly exposed side of their buildings presentable to what would be a new sort of major campus for the university. So it was like sort of drawing a veil over all these old bits of party wall and so on. And this college wanted to get as many student rooms onto that strip as possible. The strip was just wide enough for one student room and one corridor. And with that length, I think it was the tallest, narrowest building you could possibly do. And one where it was difficult to sort of think about the spatial opportunities because you had so little room to play with it. What we did was to say that, in fact, we thought the primary task was not to make the building, but to make the street. And we observed Nicholas Petzner's description of the spatial character of urban form in Oxford, which he said was always about this picturesque thing of getting a short view with an object of interest at the end. And you move towards that object of interest and realise that the next object of interest is just around the corner. And this sense of being led to narrow views and vistas was attractive to us looking across the great space of this site. So what we did was, I'm sorry, that's pixelated for some reason here, it's quite difficult to read. But I'll just give you a bearing, that's the observatory. The photograph you saw was taken from here, looking in that direction. That's Somerville College. The building we had to design was that one there, which is a very long, narrow building. And we said, look, the street that we make here will be the project. What we're going to do is make one half of the street with one hand clapping, and then ask all the other architects who come along afterwards to help us to make the other half of the street. it was good because by doing that, we were then asked to become coordinators of the whole master plan, which has then become a significant piece of work for our practice. So we've overseen a competition where Herzog & Murren are designing this building here, and Vignoli has just finished off the building here, and this one is yet to be complete. But you can see a street here which is made from these episodic views. At one end of Oxford University Press, with this great sort of Corinthian archway at the end, and the other end of the Woodstock Road. And this is a section of the building, the only section we could have. For taxation reasons, the building couldn't be connected in any way to the other building, because any dependency between that building and that building would add 20% to the budget. So they had to be completely isolated. And what you had was a maximum height, floor level, all of these floor levels had to connect back in. So everything here was really a fix. And what we concentrated on was the student rooms and trying to create views from the corridors with lanterns at each end, which I'll show you in a moment. And so here's an example of some of the existing listed buildings behind, and everywhere there was a courtyard, we opened up that courtyard and created views from the corridors into them. So from here you get a view out of the stairwell, then into that courtyard, then out through that grey room, then into that courtyard, and so on. So you're setting up views out of the passageways to relieve the compression of the corridors. And each room is then given its own special window, which represents the identity of the individual student. And so the sense of views coming from one road, you look down and see a stair tower. When you get to the stair tower, we made a little square with these two existing buildings. We've got this building in the centre open up a gap between these two buildings where they've been connected by a bad extension. And so you get a view from that square to a fountain, which is here. Then as you move down, the Palladian building and the Vignoli building, there's a garden here that you can look into. As you come further down, the view you're looking towards is this gable here, which we said the architect who designs this building has to make it a point of interest. When you get to that point of interest, you realise there's another view right down there to an existing neo-Gothic building, which is a gable. And as you get down to that gable, you realise the main view is just around the corner, which is this huge Roman triumphal arch through into the garden at the end. Coming back up, you can see the same systems applying, with views opening up. We create that gable there, someone else will create that gable there. And along the way, you get a view which we opened up into Somerville College, and there, which we opened up towards the great big observatory building, which you saw in the photographs. So the sense of moving through the city as a kind of continuous, we use the word episodic to describe the spatial character, that somehow you would feel as though you were moving through an unfolding narrative of brief episodes. And that in a way, the architecture of the individual buildings is almost secondary to this idea of the urban form. So you can see the first stair tower closing the view there, the little square, this gable will close the view, and that neo-Gothic one will close the view, and so on. And we put two major stair towers here as pepper pots, which frame the view from the observatory into the gardens of some of the foliage. And then this little sketch showing the way that the stair towers naturally at the far ends of each building to create means of escape, and then become urban markers and create a strong urban form. So that's a model of them as they're developing. A sketch looking up the street with the Vignoli building there, the 18th century building here, our flanking stair towers there. And we really pushed the detail of the timber windows to explore the depth of the timber so that you get a sense that you can only look at it very, very obliquely along a narrow lane. And so how do you design a building that will eventually only be seen at such an oblique angle? And we try to treat the detail of the depth of the timber as something that is as three-dimensional as possible. And so looking at these stair towers here flanking the entrance to Somerville College, we've made this entrance new by opening up a gap between the buildings and pepper-potting the entrance with the two stair towers. And you get a sketch of what that might be like there, looking from the street. And then there's a view of the two towers forming kind of gateway sentinels. You can get a little bit of a glimpse of the projecting buildings from there. I've tried to keep all the photographs of these buildings quite tight because they're never buildings that you can see in their entirety when the scheme is finished. So I hope that's a more true description of what they will be like. The construction of the timber windows themselves then was about the individual students in their room and projecting them out so that as you walk down this street, one difficulty with a big university campus is you get very few openings into buildings because of security issues and so on. So we wanted us to walk down the street to these be like sort of 60 or 70 lanterns on the side of the street, looking up into the soffit of a space over a student desk and seeing people at their work. And the students themselves who are looking due north would be able to get sunlight from the east and west side windows. North is the other way around, I'm sure you all know that. So it's a completely sunless orientation. But they're getting sunlight sideways in the windows. And also they're able to see, you can see six other students at their desk from your own desk by looking up and down and across this way. So it becomes a kind of an informal sort of communication. And so this is the close joinery detail of the building. One interesting aspect of this is that the whole building was built assuming traditional construction, and then let as a design and build project, where the contractor was going to give it in his own way. And he asked us to completely do all of the production information again, so that it would be entirely prefabricated, saving 2 months off the budget. It was an extraordinary thing to design the same building, just change one principle, and have to redesign all the construction again. But this is a simple window with bench and side views and shutters opening off the side. And it's a nice thing to be able to work on something in the factory and perfect one component and then know that there are going to be 80 of them built. And the contractor was highly specialised and highly professional, so they had one person whose only job was air tightness, one person whose only job was flashings, one person whose only job was capillary joints between bits of timber, and they knew everything about that. And it was a really good example of working with a big contractor where the architect is actually part of a team who have real expertise, and you're learning things from people who know more than you do. So it's a very satisfying process. This is the window itself then, looking towards the observatory. The ventilation slots at each side, the window and a little desk to sit in. So when you, the ventilation taken away from the window means you can work at your desk without having your papers blown around. And then that's the window seen from the outside when they're finished. That sense of trying to build up a kind of a three-dimensional layering by isolating the windows from each other, leaving gaps between them so each one is an independent box, and then staggering the timber back right into the depth of the reveal to create this kind of to create this kind of perceived depth in the architecture. And then the stair towers themselves were based on prefabricated staircases. It was a wonderful challenge to try and make a prefabricated staircase that's got a beautifully cast face on the top and on the bottom side. And that was perhaps the biggest challenge of the project, but they're made off-site and then cranked together and put on-site. But the result is that you can get this view up into the staircases and they become part of the urban markers at night time. And once again, pushing and pulling the depth of the construction, you can see the windows on the right-hand side are as shallow as they can be, and on the left-hand side are made very, very deep, so that you get the chance when you're walking down to first of all see right through it to the staircase and see it being entirely transparent. And as you walk past, the thing just becomes a complete wall of wood. So the depth of the construction is used to express this sort of change that you get walking past it. And the interior of the staircase itself is, in a sense, just a gratuitous lantern. These are lit up at night time, so they become kind of urban markers. And we enjoy playing with the kind of the load-bearing window mullions that come up and create a kind of a warp and weft over the ceiling. And then this is a view of the markers at night time, where they're seen as being almost entirely wood. And you can enjoy their kind of lantern-like quality. The next project is, in a way, very different. At a quiet point in the practice, we decided we'd make a project for a bit of a joke. We were very tired of that. It was in the 1990s. We were very tired of that John Paulson sort of minimal thing, the association between a certain kind of strange austerity and architectural virtue. Why is it that you're getting rid of all your possessions is seen as sort of virtuous in architectural terms? And so that idea of emptiness and the sort of empty photograph of the room, we wanted to resist in a way. So we invented the messiest environment we possibly could and said, well, couldn't that be architecture too? And the idea of it is that rather than people's possessions being something that need to be, the architecture needs to be protected from, maybe people's possessions could be the architecture. So it begins with these Glasgow tenements that used to have hanging rails in the kitchens, and people would hoist all their laundry and all their large objects into the ceiling of the kitchen. This contains musical instruments, bicycles, bits of laundry, anything large that you want to take out of the way, and it's held up in the ceiling. For example, the facade of the building just becomes the back of all the white goods. There's nothing lovelier than the back of a fridge if you like a certain kind of architecture. So this is the green facade, the glass facade of the building, showing the back of everything from the outside. And what we're doing here is it's built on a harbour on a canal near Kensal Rise Cemetery. And I'll show you the principle that we were using in terms of environmental control. The walls are made of woven glass fibre. This is unbuilt, so there's going to be no finished photographs, but these are the images that we made. The plan is simple. A deck, a balcony deck, which is made from a thicket of solar panels and wind turbines. The double height space, which you saw here with the kitchen coming in. A pool here, which is used for thermal regulation. A little mezzanine at the back with 2 bedrooms. And the whole thing is built on a floating raft structure. So we have steel flotation tanks here, which are sealed, and they float the building. And then this is a woven glass fiber building. Think of the solar panels and various other things like batteries and solar thermal on the roof. The double height facade, and you can look in and see everybody's possessions. But I wanted to make an architecture that was a bit like hiding in a hedge. So what we've done is to take the underfloor heating systems, which are made of clear plastic and are usually run through concrete floors. If you go to a building site, they're the most beautiful thing before the concrete is poured onto them. So here we just run them through the wall of the building, like the veins on your hands. And what they do is they regulate the temperature of the building by cooling it down. So the sun becomes a self-correcting mechanism. The sun powers a solar panel, also power a motor, which pumps the water through the skin of the building. And that water is pumped down below the thermocline, where the much cooler temperature down here is borrowed from these copper heating coils and taken back up into the building. So it becomes a kind of metabolism. And of course, this is a bit of a joke about buildings being instruments. This building is intended to be a kind of a Keith Robinson device that very elaborately corrects its own temperature, but sort of generates the problems that it then needs to solve. And that was intended to be part of the joke. And this is the sense of looking into the building from beneath with the sort of thicket of solar panels and so on. So we're working between CGIs and physical models to get a sense of this physical model. That's a problem of a royal public there, so we'll sense what the scale of the thing is. But the kind of almost briar or hedge-like quality we wanted the building to have. And it was meant to be a sort of a joke on the building as an instrument, or a kind of a parody on the building as an instrument. There was a funny thing, which is that it won the RIBA House the Future competition. Then it was put on their website, and a group of houseboat enthusiasts went off looking for it, and they were searching everywhere, and their own website was full of stories of where it might be and so on. And they had done this CGI, and on the right-hand side is Kensal Rise Cemetery, and on the left-hand side is the gasometer by Sainsbury's, and this is the canal. And because I love Erno Goldfinger's Trellick Tower so much, I nicked it from behind the photograph and put it into the photograph. And this drove them crazy, because nobody could find a place to stand, but that was on the left, that was on the right, and that was in front of you. But what was fabulous about it was that somebody eventually claimed that they had found it. I've had phone calls from all around the world since we've done that, with various eccentrics and ne'er-do-wells to try to build it, but no one's yet taken the bait fully yet, so I wait to see if it ever happens. Another one which is more historically embedded, but based on the idea of the building being an instrument, was built up in Preston, and maybe this is relevant to some of the issues that come up in a town like Newcastle, because Preston was the greatest linen manufacturing town in the whole world. It was getting cotton from the United States and sending it out to the colonies. These are linen mills. And of course, now linen production has completely collapsed in England, and Preston makes no linen at all anymore. But I was fascinated by cities that used to do something, that they got their identity from doing that something, and that now that identity is gone, and most people are working in financial services or insurance or call centres, they've moved into a kind of an invisible form of production where wealth is generated in a way that's completely dissociated from the environment. The reason they made linen in Preston was that it was the wettest place in Britain, that the wind came off the sea, hit the mountains in Lancashire, and just dumped down the rain on top of them. And so you had this wonderful environment for making linen. And so cotton and linen production were very, very strong here. And it became an industry that served all the colonies for about 200 years and was the beginning of industrial production. This park is a fantastic history because during the American Civil War, British Tory government were minded to support the Confederate or Southern pro-slavery cause. And they were going to protect cotton traffic coming across the Atlantic, which would allow the Confederates to continue earning money while the Union side was trying to blockade them. So the government were going to use the British Navy to support the slave side. And the cotton and linen workers in Preston went on strike in 1860 to stop the government from doing that. So these very poor people gave up their jobs and their income long before 20th century organised labour in order to protect the rights of individuals. This park is a consequence because when the strike went on, the local council built this park from the poverty labour that was produced by all the cotton workers being out of business. And this park is the outcome of it, so it's got a lot of wonderful origin. You can see the River Ribble running through here and a lovely tree-lined avenue that goes along it. We had to build a park pavilion on the side of it. This is another unbuilt project, so I'm just going to show you models. The park is so high that from the viaduct and from above, you're looking down on top of it. And I thought I'd like to make a building where the most beautiful facade is the roof. And you can see that the building projects out over the river. It's under these trees, and we have the wettest place in England. And once again, an idea that the building might become something that's only truly itself, but it's really pouring with rain. So we took the idea of a picnic cloth being laid out on the ground, and the sense that sort of warp and weft of the picnic cloth might make a subject for architecture, and began to think about the issue of looms and weaving and the framework of the loom as being a spatial matrix that was very close to built form. and we began examining rooms from all sorts of different cultures. I can't think of a more truly spatial proposition than these rooms. And sometimes the room becomes a building. It's fantastic in these photographs, the way that the activity of weaving is so closely bound into built form. And these Gerhard Richter paintings, where the dragging of the oil across the canvas gives you a tapestry-like quality. So we laid all these things down in the office as kind of touchstones for the project, and then we began making the scheme entirely through model making. I don't think we really did any drawings, or very, I think we actually did drawings at the end of the competition. But the idea of making a kind of a great frame, and then threading cables through it, and making an outdoor theatre space here, a little square under the canopy, an indoor theatre which opens its doors out into the outdoor theatre, so it becomes a stage when it opens up, public toilets, park keeper's office, and a cafe beside the river. And so this is the kind of many hands of our office. I think 8 of us just sat there for a week and a half making this model and chatting about it. And it's something we do a lot in the office, which is to take time out to make something together and find out about each other while we're making it. And these are just some detailed photographs of the structural supports for the steel cables. And the steel cables themselves then become a support for a kind of an array of environmental moderators, where solar panels, solar thermal and wind turbines kind of supported by the structure of the array overhead. But in addition to that, we wanted to make a real kind of pantomime out of the water coming down. So the thing has got a kind of cascade of gutters and pans that fill with water and so on. And they go to great elaborate trouble to sort of make their way across the top of the building and then pour out in great torrents onto the River Ribble, where they create their own kind of installation. So that was the kind of general idea for it. So here you see the plan with the outdoor theatre at the bottom of the hill, facing the indoor theatre, which becomes a stage. And then this is the covered shaded canopy. The central square goes around this huge tree where we had to respect the roof protection area, lose park keeper, various bits of gubbins, and then a cafe here, which has got a little stall selling hot chestnuts and ice cream in the summer, and then a cafe where you can sit and look at the river, and most of the time enjoy the rain coming down from the roof above. And this gives you a sense of the sort of three-dimensional property we were looking for. This kind of, it's made of technology, but it's a bit like being in a hedge, or a bit like being in a forest or something. And then this is the plan of the whole building with the river on the bottom, and the trees growing up through it, becoming part of the architecture. And then we can see the different ways in which the water is being moderated and altered before it all comes gushing down, drenching the cafe windows and landing in the river. That's a section through the building. The model of the cafe, the little hut for selling chestnuts, and the glazed cafe building itself, and that sense of it coming off the end where you have the water gushing down into the river. So that's the sense of the building as being like a kind of a huge instrument, but one which refers to the history of the city in some way. The last two projects I want to talk about are the ones which are very difficult in terms of difference, in terms of the conditions of production. One of them is a gift from the Australians, a company called Lendlease, I think they're one of you or something. So the British government, the London government, when they won the Olympics, were not going to take the risk of building all the buildings themselves. So the whole of the athletes' village was subcontracted out to developers, and Lendlease won the permission to build all of the housing to build and fund all of the housing for the Olympics. Now, this is one of these things that I'm interested in, where what you get is a kind of a three-legged race between values and growth. So the government were not prepared anymore to take a risk of development, so they sell that risk out to a developer at a relatively high price. And that developer, in all fairness to their own rational system, is pursuing the bottom line. On the other hand, the government is making a building for the Olympics. It has to have some heraldic or representative form. It has to in some way represent the best of British. So they make a framework of the 20, what they thought were the best young practices in the country. And they gave that framework to Lendlease and said, can you give each of those architects a job when you build it? Lendlease, being rational people, realised that the building stock would be sold on to social landlords, intermediate, and market landlords after the Olympics. And each of those constituencies have their own space standards, which come in documents about that thing. On top of that, you've got the London codes. And on top of that, what you've got is the Olympic codes, which are extraordinary. It says that high jumpers can't sleep on floors above 3 floors up and all that. It's kind of incredibly complex. And Lendlease says, we're not going to get 20 or 25 architects trying to solve that problem. So in a way which is entirely rational by their own lights, they said, what we'll do is we'll get one firm to design a chassis. And that chassis will be the core form for the building. And it will be standard for all the buildings on the site. And then we'll get 25 architects to design facades for those buildings. But then they looked at the architects and thought, well, we're risk averse and we don't know these people. So they got four of them and said, can you design all the facades? At which stage the three-legged race began, because the Olympic Authority said, no, you need to use all 25. So then these rang up the four who they trusted and said, can you appoint all of these 25 people to the facades as sub-consultants to you? So the whole thing was sort of shocked out. What ended up was that each building was designed by six different architects. And you had a landscaping architect, you had a master planning architect, you had a core form chassis architect, you had the main floor architects, you had a facade architect, and you had the detailed development architect. And I thought that was significant because what we hold into ourselves is the authenticity and our mastery of the process. And here it had been project managed away from us for reasons that you might say are absurd, but by the likes of the London Authority and by Mendeley's, they would say they were entirely rational. And that creates a conundrum for architecture. And we wanted to some way express that conundrum. So here's the huge athlete's village, 10 stories high, blocks and squares and so on. And this is our little block here. Glenn Howells, who was our main guy, he's a very nice architect, very bluff. He was doing all four blocks, and we were designing the facade for this. And Glenn said, you can do anything you like as long as you haven't got those bloody syncopated windows that are everywhere at the moment. The other ones that mullions don't line up as they come down. So that was our brief, and we were given this block here. And the inside is absolutely standardized across the whole site. And the Olympic Development Authority, with their Committee of the Great and the Good, argued this is the way in which London squares and French squares have been developed in the 18th century. And when I was being interviewed, because what you get is a standard facade with organic development behind it, with people buying up plots, this was their argument for this as a kind of a good cultural idea. When I was interviewed for it, I pointed out that in fact it's the exact opposite, because the homogeneity here is in the core form of the building, it's in the hidden bit, and then you're getting this hysteria of difference of 25 architects trying to compete with each other to produce something which is a bit different on the outside. So I thought that this was something that was worth investigating, and we began with Corbusier's domino houses, because that is kind of promise in the domino house as an idea, and I became fascinated by Corbusier's ideas about industrialization. He was obsessed by a man called Taylor, who invented a system called Taylorism, which is a scientific division of labor. And I thought, well, Corbusier wrote about it in really stirring terms. He said, every production task will be broken down into the smallest components, like a Ford motor car. And then over all of that, there will be the calm, dispassionate planner who brings it all to a synthesis. Of course, Corbusier thought that planner would be the architect. But if you reap the wind, you sow the whirlwind. If manufacturing can be tailorized, then so can design. And if you want a dispassionate person to oversee it, why have architects with their aesthetic cults and their values and all that sort of stuff? Why not just have a project manager? They're really dispassionate. And so that's how it's ended up, that Corbusier's idea of the architect is synthesizing a broken-up process means that the architect gets eaten by the beast that he admired most of all. So these are Corbusier's images of the Parthenon, which he saw as being the embodiment of the tailorized process. He says, Phidias, the great sculptor, is the mind that can bring it all together. But everybody else is just operating by perfecting the little bits themselves. And he compares that to the Delage motor car. And we wanted to look at the Parthenon in a different way and say, rather than being this abstract, tailorized thing that Corbusier promised it was, is it not the outcome of a very particular set of circumstances? And it has the idealization of the Parthenon being something which is much to do with the problem about the way in which we read architecture. So here are the Parthenon stones, which I think are probably the most famous and most damaged and most idealized things in the world. They're currently in the British Museum, they're called the Elgin Marbles. And they were built for a cult site on a hill, with the light, as you can see, bouncing off the ground and coming up into the shade of the eaves. They're meant to be seen in a very particular way by a procession of people who pass on certain days, worshipping particular cults which have got to do with their society. And the meaning of the building, the meaning of the sculpture, is supposed to be integrated. So what happens over 2,000 years, they're burnt in a fire in the 2nd century, they're defaced by Christians, the Turks use it as a garrison, it's then blown up by the Venetians under Morosini. The Lord Elgin comes along and takes the stones away. The Greeks call them stones and the British call them marbles, because Lord Elgin taking them away didn't take the whole blocks away, he just cut the veneer off the front of the block. So they lost their tectonic identity as part of the wall and they became veneer panels. They're brought in a ship and sunk off Cape Sillian and have to be rescued by pearl divers. And then they're brought to London, which is the most polluted city in the history of the earth, and put in this room with coal fires where they're idealized endlessly by British artists and philosophers, while at the same time turning into these extraordinarily sort of beautiful but polluted and scarred things. The worst damage they ever suffered was when Duveen in the 1930s decided that they should be white and secretly paid museum workers to take them to the basement and ship the colour off. Of course, they were never white, and now they're permanently damaged. So that sense of something being physically damaged but endlessly idealised and removed from the site where it gained all its meaning and sense of large into the world seemed to me to be appropriate to a festival which is going to be televised for billions of people and leave behind a residue of building stock in the city. And we were fascinated by the way in which in London these stones were put all, copies of these stones were put all over buildings like National Regent's Park. All of the Parthenon sculptures are used to bedeck the buildings to kind of guarantee the value of these speculative developments. And so we looked at these images by Andy Warhol, and any of you who go into the museum in Sydney at the moment, it's a fantastic exhibition of work by Sol LeWitt, where he deals with grids, and he's a fantastic philosopher of the grid. And both of them talk about how the grid neutralizes or almost anesthetizes things. And Andy Warhol says, if you take an image, however evocative or provocative it is, if you repeat it often enough, it loses all its meaning and produces a kind of a numbness. And so that sense of these very famous things being potentially held in the grid-like matrix and endlessly duplicated, we thought would guarantee their sense of being artifacts that are truly lost. So we went into the museum overnight and used a process, and we didn't invent the bits of the process, but I think we invented the process. Here we are from the office, we're locked in, here are the cleaners working all night, and the museum is completely empty. These are the Parthenon stones. And then this piece of equipment here is software, projector, and SLR camera. Here's a beautiful relief of the horses on the stones. I had all sorts of ideas about what we were going to photograph, but the keeper of the stones came down and said, Neil, just photograph the horses. The people of London will really love the horses. So we changed all of our scheme overnight and just made photographs of the horses. And the photographs are three-dimensional digital images. So we passed projections over the stones, photographed them endlessly, and while the projection is passing over it, the computer software is recognizing the deviation from the mean that these lattices and grids have, and therefore inferring three-dimensional depth into them. By doing that, we create a three-dimensional digital file which we bring back to the office. So that's the neck of a horseman next there, and that's the shoulder of a horseman, and that's his nose and face. And what we did was to very quietly digitally take all the upper surfaces of these models and take it from being undercut in this direction and just pull it up like that. You can't see it, but what it means is that when it's put on a building in London, the frost won't stick behind it and crack the concrete. And so there's a kind of a bit of sort of dark art of changing figures to sculptures in the digital medium. And then using rapid prototyping technology, we turn a three-dimensional digital photograph into what we call a digital positive. You can see that it's midway through the routing process, so you can still see the coarseness of the routing procedure here. But eventually they produce digital plugs, which are like this. And what I love about this is that this is the damage that was done to the stones in the fire in 200 BC, and it's been duplicated perfectly in the digital medium. So this is like a medium density board, which we then make a latex negative out of, and you can see the latex negative is being used as formwork in this image. And then we create precast concrete positives out of it. Sometimes a building, when it's being made, produces things that you can never see again. I was up to Lincolnshire, which is a very flat, cold area of England, in the middle of winter with a low mist on the ground, and this brown fenland stretching in every direction in the winter dawn, and saw 500 of these white horse panels just standing in the field by themselves. It was like a kind of ghost army. But what's funny about these panels, you can see them being produced here, is that they have got a beam, and a column, and an infill panel, and they shove the insulation on the back, and Bob's your uncle, goes straight onto the concrete frame. So the sense of the outside of the building as being a kind of a representative form, that you have a core form behind, and then everything is represented on the outside again as a separate thing, we found interesting as an idea. And because we said that the structure would be at zero, everything on the mould is then plus zero, and it starts to cast shadows onto the concrete face. And you can see the way they're knitted together here at the corners. We had a kind of an indifference to the construction process, because in a sense it wasn't ours. So we set the thing up with a set of very clear and simple rules. And said, well, when the windows go in, it's not really any more architecture than it is when they're not in. We made this very provocative drawing, which is an algorithm, which we gave to the quantity surveyors and the project managers from Lendlease. And what it says is that if you want to save money on the building, don't come to those awful VE meetings with us where you're wringing your hands and pretending you're not enjoying yourself. What you have to do is to just apply this algorithm, and it gives you all the variations a building can have: depth of relief, undercutting of relief,
number of variations of panel, etc., so a mix of concrete, and by simply pressing the button and putting your new budget in, it will tell you what the release should be like. For some reason, it was a very practical thing at Monsets, so they absolutely hated it. I think they felt they were being somehow caricatured. But I'll tell you, just to go back to the three-legged race for a moment, we had a designer review meeting for the London Olympics, and most of the people in the room were sort of senior architects and senior architectural advisors and journalists and so on, and then we had the project managers. And somebody who was well-meaning and important was put in charge of this panel, and they said, at least 25 architects, we don't want a zoo. I need to invent some rule that everybody can obey. So he thought about it and came up with this idea that every building should have a base, a middle, and a top. This was going to unify them all. And I was at the crypt, and I said, well, our building depends entirely on it having a grid, and the grid must be completely neutral. It must be like a kind of, you know, it's like a kind of an abstract game. It's like a mathematical game. You can't start giving it base, middle, and top. And he said, well, couldn't you have a bit of a base, middle, and top? Just a little bit of a base, middle, and top. And I was saying, well, it's not a question of how much or how little. It's a question of whether you have it at all. And the project manager was sitting there for a while, and he suddenly went, you, base, middle, top, Monday. That was his assumption. Of course, the office were very crestfallen, but I went back and said, give it a base, middle, and top for Monday, because I know that there's a value engineering meeting on Wednesday, so we should be back in business by Friday, which we were. So we sort of really rode the snake on this one. We really played the game. And I'm not sure if we would have got away with it entirely, because I think that the contracting side felt that we were pulling their leg in some way, which we probably were. But Boris Johnson, the London mayor, decided he liked the horses, so that probably gave us a fair amount to do it. And you can see these drawings we made, which are like this kind of mathematical game. Five panels we could afford to photograph and produce, and then these five plugs could be cut down in different ways to create different spaces between the windows that are produced by the core form designer. So what we're saying here is that all of these 25 panels fit all of the gaps that you have between windows on the building. And what we're going to do is, we don't want to try and, we're not designing this building in the way that an architect would. This is a different game. It's a game with rules, and the rules have to play out. So Adam, one of our architects, found what he thought was the most truly random process on earth. And he put these panels into the computer, and they just produced a facade, which we had absolutely no control over compositionally, except the decision about the grid and the issue about the horses. But the horses are disposed in such a way that there's no logical or visual connection between them. So when you look at it, you try to find a pattern, there's none there to find. And you can see how that works out then as a piece of constructed form with the different panels on the building. This is the facade of the balcony facing the main square. And this gives you a sense of the kind of ruggedness you get when the panel is pressed forward and the frame is kind of embossed back into the building. I enjoyed, it was a kind of a neo-classical architect in the 80s who always drew his building with the curtains blowing in the wind. So I liked the kind of idea of the contractor's quality and just flapping about. And this sense of this kind of endless carousel of horses and riders that just goes round and round the building within a grid. And you can see it sort of settling into the London building stock from the 1960s in the background. And what I'm rather hoping is that as time goes on, the people will put fridges and pot plants and bicycles and their children and all the sort of stuff they don't want in the house out onto the balcony. I think these horses will become almost invisible in the city. At the moment, they have a kind of a bare presence. But more and more, I hope they just disappear into the city, and sometimes somebody will ask their parents what these horses are about. But this gives you a sense of what the building is, what the building is like. The National Greek newspaper, because of the controversy over the Alban Marbles, the National Greek newspaper had a major front page headline about this, which said, "This architect is in league with the devil." But then being Greeks, they went, but maybe he's not. Maybe he's pro-Greek. Maybe he's in league with the devil. Maybe he's pro-Greek. The whole thing was sort of debated quite a bit in Greece. Eventually the Greek team came and stayed in the building, so it was nice to see all the Greek flags hanging up it. And then this gives you a sense of the pleasure of making a three-dimensional form and then just cutting it and seeing what gives. The final project I want to talk about is the chapel that we designed in Oxfordshire. And it's almost the exact opposite to everything I've been talking about for the last 5 minutes. Because here, in a sense, the conditions of production were perfect for an architect. It was a competition which we won, and at the competition interview, my project architect read out this poem. I read a few now. The annals say, and the monks of Combat Noise were at prayer inside the oratory, a ship appeared above them in the air. The anchor dragged along behind so deep it hooked itself into the altar rails, and then, as the big hull rocked to a standstill, a crewman shinned and grappled down the rope and struggled to release it, but in vain.
This man can't bear our life down here and will drown, the abbot said, unless we help him. So they did. The freed ship sailed, and the man climbed back out of the marvellous as he had known it.
So this is a wonderful poem by Seamus Heaney, and the image on the left-hand side is from Abbas Hilda's Psalter from the 8th century. It shows Jesus in the ship on the Sea of Galilee. And what we said at the competition interview is that the image of the anchor is clearly relating to the crucifix, and the man on the anchor is clearly related to the figure of Christ. And we knew that in the Middle Ages they had this theory about the upper air and the lower air. And I tell you that this poem is a translation of the Annals of Cormac Noyes, and they're from the 9th century in Ireland, and they tell this as fact. On the next page they tell you about a hailstorm that happened the next day, and they tell you about lightning. And so they're writing down as pure fact or pure science all of these things. And the ship in the air was seen by them in the same way as a hailstone fire. It was an extraordinary vision, but one that appears to have emerged in different places in Britain, Ireland, around the same time. And what I loved about it was that the missing word in it is the word nave. And the word nave is both the root of the word for a ship, as in naval, but it's also the nave, which is the Latin word for the body of a church. So somewhere in the development of churches, the idea of the church being a ship of souls and the relationship between church construction and the space of the church gets tied into that of the ship. And it's a really powerful identification that continues through history. And so we made, this is the site, which on the right-hand side is built arts and crafts buildings in the 19th century. It's a theological college. And what we said was that our building is the one here. These are the buildings by G Street, the arts and crafts buildings. I'll just pause for a moment and tell you about the programme, and I'll come back to the name. There's a beautiful circle of trees here, Scots Pine, Spanish Chestnut, Holly, Copper Beech, and then this huge beech tree here, which is the biggest beech tree in England. It was planted in 1711, and it sort of stands on the top of the hill, and then the hill swoops down quite steeply and comes back up the far side. So when you're standing here looking across the valley, all you see is these meadows going up the far side. It's a beautiful English landscape. The Theological College, which is here, it's lovely because most of the Anglican students are grown up and they have children and families. So there's about 100 kids on the site and lots of students. But this elderly order of nuns who were dying out in a house on the far side of Oxford asked to come and stay in the college while they retired and for their own, seeing out their own lives and the time of the order. And it was a small nunnery plan for them here. And they brought, as a gift for their college, the chapel, which was the subject of the competition. The chapel is positioned between the trees. You can see on this plan here the alignment between the trunk of the beech and the door of the chapel, and the window of the chapel here, and a tiny gap between the trees, which gives you a view out towards Carson. And then we took a number of images which we wanted to use as being central to the project. The buoyancy of the ship in the air, this idea of a great airship. And we said at the competition interview, we wanted to produce a kind of a spatial duplication, which is when you were in the chapel, I wanted you to feel as though you were both within the ship on its deck, among the masts, and at the same time below the ship looking up at it. And I wanted to feel as though you were in both places at the same time. The second identification is that the word nave also refers to the very still point of a turning wheel. And I love the idea that something is that's going to send ministers, trained ministers all around the world, that somehow represents itself as a still point of a turning world. And the final one was this image that I felt strongly myself was a character I wanted the architecture to have, which is that the kite flyer is both being lifted aloft, and their eyes are up there in the air and the light, but their feet are really cleaving onto the ground. And that relationship between trying to hold yourself onto the ground and the thrumming of the line and the sense of being lifted up into the light, I'm not a practicing Christian myself, but I thought, wouldn't that be a good thing for a Christian experience? And we made this model, first of all, which is a piece of plasticine or molding clay. And we put our thumb into it and said the first mark in the ground becomes the place for the gathering of the community. And then you can put the mark in the ground on the brow of the hill beneath the great beech tree. And within that you can situate the two things that are central to Christian worship. The Bible, which is the liturgy of the word, and the altar, which is the liturgy of the Eucharist, those two crosses. And then above that you might make a frame, which somehow is a duplication of the trees around you, but also creates a clearing. So the idea of the illuminated clearing as being central to Christian experience, and that clearing might be a place for the gathering of the community. And then that might be that duplication, that double reading, that the community on the ground within the space of the structure are duplicated above by the ship in the air, which has got its association with the ship of souls and with the disciples on the Sea of Galilee with Jesus, which we saw in the image earlier on. And so this very quick first sketch, which we put on a competition brochure, which is about light coming through the trees. And we had this funny thing, which is, we called the skipping rope. It was going to be a white wall that went all the way around, and the light from the clear story would print itself onto the white wall with this kind of shape. And it was the first thing that we drew, and we spent the whole project looking for and trying to make sure that we got it. So you get a clear story, a white wall, an earthwork with a community within it, and the light coming through the trees down into that space. This is a new college in Oxford, and it shows you what a collegiate chapel is like. The congregation face each other, and the form is called antiphonal. They pray back and forth. So that one side prays and the other side answers, and it passes back and forth. And when we went to the composition briefing, there are a lot of compositions in Britain, and they have these briefing days which are very cagey, because all six practices are there, and we don't want to ask any questions that would give away what we're thinking. And the client is trying to enthusiastically describe the project and wondering why no one is asking any questions. And the whole thing always has a slightly stilted feeling. But here we have a congregation across from each other with the lectern and the altar between them, which is a collegiate form of worship. And what the client said was, just as he was talking and explaining collegiate chapels, because I noticed that his hands started to creep in like that, and I thought, he's thinking about community, I know what he's thinking about. So we made that a photograph in the competition brochure and said, couldn't it be not so parallel and more curved around to sort of give a sense of gathering? And then if you're going to start curving, you might as well go the whole hog and do that. And what happens when you do that is you create an ellipse, and an ellipse is an extraordinarily charged form, formally, but also in terms of Christian worship. Because in Christian symbolism, the circle or the sphere is the emblem of God, because it radiates endlessly out from a still centre. While the line is the emblem of man, because we're bound into time's arrow. And so going through the world and the journey of our lives is seen as a line. So the bringing together of the circle and the line in a geometric form gives you the ellipse. So then we began to read different ellipses that we knew. I'm short of time, so I'm not going to go through every one of them, but on the left is the really important one, which is Rudolf Schwarz's church in Frankfurt from 1950. And those of you who know your contemporary architecture will realize it's an ellipse with a beautiful continuous clear story around the top, and an external precast concrete structural frame. And those of you who know your contemporary architecture will see that plan is Peter Zumthor in St. Benedict in Switzerland. And he takes Schwarz's ellipse, and he takes his clear story, but he just moves the concrete frame one move in so it's inside the walls. Otherwise, it's a very, very similar thing. And so what we've done is to move our frame one step further to create an endless ambulatory around the outside and a kind of an inner and an outer space within the building. And then these much older church plans, the idea of the ambulatory that comes from St. Constance on the Palatine Chapel of Appen. This San Vitale, which is like this lovely lozenge attached to the edge of the plan. We've emulated that. And Canterbury Cathedral, where you get these forms that are just clustering off the outside of a central crystalline form. And we love this idea of a cluster of rough forms that are centered on the altar. So the plan of our building came about through that. Here's how we work in the office. Eight architects sitting around the table, scribbling over the pencil. You can see the development of this sheet here. It's from the idea of the ellipse being clasped within a major rectangular form. So it's a void within a rectangle. And bit by bit by bit, you go, what the hell? You can lose the whole rectangle and just sort of this cluster of forms around the outside. And so that's the development of the plan as it goes. But what it gives you is a crystalline centre, which is the ellipse and the structural containment, community sitting inside the structure, and then everything that's about difference, the place of reservation, the window out towards Garsington, the sister's prayer room, the door in from the convent, the sacristy, are just kind of thrown willfully off the ellipse. So you get a combination between an asymmetrical and a crystalline form. And then what we did was to say that the ambulatory in plan gives you this space between the structure and the wall that you could walk around. But if we take the keel of the roof, the ship in the air, and allow it to rise up and hold it on the structure here, that you can introduce light between the ceiling and the top of the structure, and that gives you a kind of an illuminated space beyond the space that you're in, towards which your soul might reach out into in terms of a spatial idea of Christian contemplation. And so this sense of a building within a building, or a ship in a bottle, was a powerful driver of the scheme. And you can see then when we look at the long section that over the focus of the ellipse here and over the focus of the ellipse here, the roof just sweeps up to the clear story at the edge. Mariah here in the office, she was a project architect, and we made this model for the client. Paul Gilleron, the acoustic engineer, built a perfect digital acoustic model of the chapel to balance out the speaking and singing voice. And we could then play different sounds into that model and listen to it on headphones. And at the same time, we made this model as a hat. you could wear on your head, and so you could take it onto site, and here we are. And because we said it's all about the light coming through the trees. The light coming through the trees is the most important thing. And so that was how we worked. So this is an image of what it might be like to be inside the model. Okay, I'm going to finish quickly. Very quickly, I'm going to whiz through this. It's a drawing we made on the ground in Dublin, in University College Dublin, and it was just between production and completion of the building. So it's a plaster floor. It took us a week, 7 of us from the project team, just to draw and set out the building. And I just whizzed through the drawings. I was talking today about sometimes making something which is beside the project, which becomes your kind of touchstone to the project. And so this is my project team making it. Medieval masons used to draw on plaster floors in the old cathedrals. So that's an image of a finished drawing for us, isn't it? And finally, I'll just take you quickly through the construction. The ellipse on the ground under the great beech tree, the ellipse rising up, the timber structure like a ship in a bottle dropped into it, riding aloft on top of the ship in the air. That's before they put the ceiling on in the middle around the Oxfordshire countryside. They placed the ship on top of it, the underside of the ship. The buildings are clearing in trees, the structures are clearing in trees, the structure itself, the building clearing completion. So this is the skipping rope of light on the white wall. I'll tell you one thing quickly, I've been told to hurry up, is that the sisters, I said there should be no coloured glass in the building, and the sisters really wanted coloured glass, so they eventually conceded they shouldn't have it, but they said to me very pointedly that they were going to go away and pray. And what I didn't realise is that the ventilation panels up here are single glazing, and when you open them you get this extraordinary neutron spectra all over the walls of the building. So the sisters were very pleased with themselves. The idea of the community, since within a structure, and that the breach in that structure is an opening to heaven, a gaping hole in the building that opens towards heaven, so the structure becomes an emblem of the community, and when it opens up you get that sense of opening towards the white walls which represent heaven. The lectern is addressing the listening community, so the seats around the lectern, and the structure itself is an embodiment of the Christian community. These are the computer drawings of the structure, kind of their crown of thorns face. And then the structure itself is the illuminated ceiling beyond it. The quiz through these, this is the sense of the structure. It kicks back these little spurs which take all the lateral loading of the structure back into the elliptical wall. And then this is the space of the chapel itself. And then this interstitial space between the wall and the structure, which is just that you can wander around the outside. And there's our skipping rope of light at last, this kind of ellipse of light that plays on the white wall all the time. The entrance from the door is under the beech tree and takes you into the lectern where you have the gospel. The entrance from the nunnery space is into their own private prayer room, which is a tiny space which picks up their very fragile voices, their elderly women. And this looks out then towards the altar. You can see the space of the tabernacle here is blue light coming straight off the sky wall. It's just north light coming off the sky. So when you put the tabernacle into it, it really fizzes in the north light. And then the little window that looks out through the gap in the trees towards Garsington. So here it is, it's a projecting stone cantilever. You can see it here. And then the view out towards Garsington with the gap in the trees. The bell tower is on the axis of the sisters coming in and the students coming in, and it meets at that axis. And they took the bell from the sisters' old house and from the theological college, and they melted it and made a new bronze bell out of the two pieces of bronze they had melted, and it says, "We two become one." So here's the bell tower with the bell in it, and the centre that they're on the side of the building at the axial point. A quick shot of the sacristy where they laid the vestments out. And then this is the schema of the building with all the theological ideas brought together. Finally, this idea that Semper has, that weaving is the art that separates the inside from the outside, and the woven screen is what separates the inner from the outer life. So we make a stone woven screen from clips from stone. It's a dogtooth bond, and it's intended to sort of embody the idea of weaving in a permanent form. The stone window mullions above that, and perhaps I'll end here with an image of the ship in the air.